I'm going to talk about Ronald Fisher and maximum likelihood estimation. This is Ronald Fisher, for those who don't know. This is a picture when he was 23. And the work that he did that I'm going to talk about was between 1912 and 1922, when he was in his 20s and early 30s. It's his first major scientific statistical work that kind of made his reputation. This is a brief outline of it. I'll say a little bit of myself. Ken already introduced me, so I'll just go through that pretty quickly. I'll talk sort of about what maximum likelihood is, just the very beginning. We'll go back and go into more detail. I'll give a little bit about probability and statistics. Probably this audience, most people know more than I'll talk about, but I just want to refresh people on sort of a little bit about probability and statistics. I'm going to talk a little bit about mathematical modeling before Fisher. So Fisher started from mostly stuff in astronomy and also eugenics, and I want to say a little bit about what came before him that gave rise to his research and his, you know, major contributions. And I'm going to talk about Ronald Fisher himself and his work that he did between 1912 and 1922. It culminates in a paper in 1922 where he actually calls it maximum likelihood, and which is kind of what a lot of what, if you read textbooks on maximum likelihood, it's pretty much what he wrote in that paper in 1922. I'm going to talk about modern maximum likelihood estimation with computers, with nonlinear optimization, with huge data sets and things that Fisher never dealt with. A conclusion, a Q&A. About questions, if you can keep questions at the end, please do so. But if something's just not clear, I haven't defined a term right, things like that, it's better to ask it during the presentation so you don't get further lost. As Ken said, I have worked in various mathematical areas. I use maximum likelihood methods for my Ph.D. thesis, and then at a number of places I've worked, like HB Labs and a couple of companies, where I worked on products that incorporated maximum likelihood concepts. So basically, maximum likelihood is a very powerful method. It's widely used, not just in scientific research. It underlies a lot of products. Global positioning system is probably the most widely used example of these kind of techniques. If you've heard of Kalman filters, which are used in all kinds of things, that's actually technically a maximum likelihood method. It's used by speech recognition programs, like Right in Naturally Speaking, Carnegie Mellon Sphinx program. It is used by, how many people know what Swipe is? It's a smart keyboard not too many. Okay, well, Swipe, it uses a lot of the same ideas that are in speech recognition programs. Is another successful example of it. It was used in the detection of the Higgs boson, a Large Hadron Collider in CERN. It's very heavily used in particle physics. That's where my degree comes from. How I got exposed to these methods. I don't think anybody ever mentioned Fisher the entire time I was in graduate school. It sort of fell magically from the sky, and no one seemed to know where it came from. It's used in many other fields. Fisher wrote a number of papers and books, and then these were more popularized by other scientists in the 20s and 30s who made his work more accessible, and they spread all through the English-speaking world. I'll talk a little bit about that. So the global positioning system is in all your phones, is what probably got you here today, if you don't come from the area. It's a system of satellites. I think there's 24 of them in orbit around the Earth. They all send out timing signals. You need to be able to see at least 4 of them from wherever you're standing, and from the 4 timing signals, the appropriate calculations and modeling of the noise and even general relativity, the clocks are supposed to slow down in these GPS satellites just a little bit. So to get a very precise estimate of where you are involves a very complex mathematical calculation. And this is something developed by the Defense Department back in, I think, the 70s and 80s, and now it's become almost a necessity for us. So this is probably one of the most commonly used examples of maximum likelihood. Here's an example of several papers on maximum likelihood estimation methods for GPS. Dragon Naturally Speaking, how many people have actually used Dragon Naturally Speaking? Had a couple of people say so. So the Hidden Markov Model speech recognition that's in Dragon Naturally Speaking and all of the traditional speech recognition programs is an example of a maximum likelihood method. Now, there are newer methods, and I'll talk a little bit about deep learning and neural networks in a while, which really are not maximum likelihood. But this is CMU Sphinx. This is Carnegie Mellon's open source speech recognition program. So if you're really interested, you can dig through the documentation and code for this and see in detail how these things are done and how these statistical models are applied in a real application. This is Swipe for people that don't recognize it or have never seen it. It allows you to enter text faster than just typing individual buttons on your phone or on your iPad, for example. It works, you just drag your finger along the different keys that you would press, so it's faster. It has obviously some drawbacks because, in fact, sometimes you make mistakes and some words actually have the same swipe. The obvious example being like two and T-O-O, and there's quite a number. So it uses statistical maximum likelihood methods to estimate the probability of what you intended to enter. And it also gives you a list of most likelies. So I enter John, but maybe I meant some other, or trying to enter join, so I can select from these choices if it made a mistake. It did not, in fact, give you what you wanted to enter. And a lot of this technology, a lot of statistical language modeling is pretty much the same as what you'll find in a speech recognition program. It's pretty much the same methods. Swipe's very successful. It has a lot of users. It was sold to Nuance for $102 million in cash, not stock, in 2011. And it's still the market leader. There's several clones of it. You may, if you poke around on your Android phone or your iPhone, you may find one. Samsung has one, and there's a couple of others. This is the Higgs boson discovery with Large Hadron Collider. It got the Nobel Prize in 2013. And so the Higgs is a particle that's predicted by the so-called standard model of physics, which tries to unify electromagnetism and the weak nuclear force. That's the, like radium, the number of isotopes you might run into. The weak nuclear force is what drives them. And it predicted the existence of something called the Higgs boson, which is quite sort of unexpected. It's a bit of a mathematical hack, sort of, to get everything to work out correctly. So the existence of the Higgs boson has always been a big question mark for this model. And so this is the discovery plot showing the peak from the Higgs boson. So what you need to do is do, and I'll talk more about the modeling process, but you do a maximum likelihood fit, where you have to take into account these backgrounds, these other processes that might be faking the Higgs boson, creating a spurious peak. And so the method is able to tell you, to estimate the strength of the signal, the mass at which it occurs, and properties of a particle. So I'll give just a little bit about probability and statistics. So the dictionary definition of probability isn't very helpful. What we can hear from Merriam-Webster is the extent to which something is probable, the likelihood of something happening or being the case. The rain will make the probability of their arrival even greater. That's kind of circular. What do we mean by probability? And this is a very deep question that I don't think has been fully resolved. So there are two major families of theories about what probability means. And I'm going to talk mostly about the frequentist, because that's loosely what Fisher actually did. He kind of rejected what he came to call Bayesian probability. But in that, in frequentist statistics, probability is interpreted as a rate of frequency. So if we say that a coin has a 50-50 chance of coming up heads or tails, what we mean is if you flip the coin a lot, like 100 times, in general you get 50 heads and 50 tails. And the longer you go, the closer you'll get to the probability. So it's interpreted as a frequency and a rate, and in no other way. That means that it is not very well defined unless you have something you can repeat, like flipping a coin over and over again, that behaves pretty much the same way every time you do it. And it also means for these things to work, you typically have to have a certain amount of data, which is not clear. If you flip a coin one time, what does a rate mean? What does probability mean? It really isn't very well defined. And so there's always been a debate about, well, exactly how many repetitions before it's okay to talk about a rate. So that's the frequentist definition. It doesn't apply to various, like, one-off events, and as I'll say, it doesn't apply to a way that we actually talk about probabilities frequently. That is the other theory, which, thanks to Fisher, is now called Bayesian probability. And in this probability, we're talking about a state of knowledge or a state of belief, a level of certainty that we have about something being true. But if you think about it, we think about this and we talk about this all the time. You might know a bunch of people. How sure are you that they like you? You might be pretty sure with one person, you know, 99% sure, but probably you're never totally sure. maybe your parents, maybe a few special people, but in general, there's some, you know, probability. Another person, it might be 50%, it might be 10%, it might be very close to zero, depending on your experiences. It's often not totally certain. It's a state of knowledge, and it's something, in that case, we probably can never be absolutely sure of. But we use probability in this sense of saying how sure we are of something. And we have some things, I'm sure I can't walk through this wall, it's not going to work. That's something I'm 100% sure of. But there are other things. Are there aliens in outer space? I have no idea. Right? I have no evidence, no experience. I have zero certainty of whether that's true or not. So actually, I would probably say a 50-50 chance. I don't know. Even there, it gets hard to define what you mean. So this is another concept of probability. And there are whole theories based on trying to work out the implications of these ideas. And they've gone back and forth in popularity. So at the time that Fisher started his work, what he eventually labeled as Bayesian probability was kind of the dominant view. And in his work, he ran into problems with the dominant Bayesian theory that led him to reject it and go for something more like the frequentist theory. So frequentism ruled up until, I don't know, the 80s or something like that. And it's made something of a comeback. So you'll often see, like in machine learning, about Bayesian this and Bayesian that. And but the problems, there are problems with both of these ways of interpreting probability. Bayesian, the problem that Fisher ran into was you assume some sort of prior probability. And usually the way that you kind of hack around, well, what should we use as a prior probability to say, make it uniform over all our choices? But then they're kind of like, what are all the choices? And uniform in what? So when he was trying to interpret maximum likelihood in a Bayesian way, and there is actually a Bayesian version of maximum likelihood that I won't talk about, he said, well, okay, so is it uniform in the parameter, or the sine of the parameter, or the parameter squared? And depending on what prior probability you assume, you actually would get different results, different estimates of parameters, and we'll see when it's applied to classification, you could get a different classification. And Fisher didn't like that. He thought that's not the way to do it. So he decided to go with what came to be called frequentist. And I'll go into his disputes with his rivals, but because of various disputes over the foundations of his theory, his version of probability is not the standard frequentist theory, but it's kind of frequentist. And generally, almost all presentations of maximum likelihood and people who are using it are using a frequentist, basically a frequentist interpretation of statistics. So yeah, that's basically what I just said. So is that all right? Anybody have anything they want me to clarify? Okay, so we talk about maximum likelihood. Maximum likelihood is, at one level, a pretty common sense, I would say, idea. And the idea is that we estimate parameters, might be the position of something. Where is Mars? I take a bunch of measurements of the planet Mars. Where is it? Well, I'm not perfect, the telescopes aren't quite perfect, there's weather in the atmosphere, so I get a series of measurements. And they'll probably be concentrated around where Mars actually is, and a few will be way off. And so the maximum likelihood estimator is given some model of the errors, the problems in measurement. What is the most likely position? What would predict the highest probability for the distribution of measurements that I see? And that's what maximum likelihood is. And for simple cases, like where you have maybe just one thing you're measuring, one number, like the angular position of Mars along the zodiac, it can turn out to be something very simple, like the mean, the average of the numbers that you've measured. And so at one level, it's a fairly simple concept. What we'll see is it gets more difficult as you apply it to more complex problems, larger dimensions of measurements, many measurements that are related, to classification problems, like deciding whether an animal that you see is a cat or a dog. If you get into these more complicated cases, it gets more involved, more difficult to do. So let me give a simple example of this, which is flipping a coin, so-called binomial distribution. So when you flip a coin, you have two choices. It could come up heads, or it could come up tails. And you usually think that the coin has some probability that it's going to come up heads and tails. And we normally think of a fair coin as 50-50. On average, if I flip it, I'm going to get heads half the time and tails half the time. If I'm a gambler or I'm certain other things, I might want to know, is this really a fair coin? Is it rigged to come up heads more than tails? So how do I do that? Well, I flip the coin a lot, and I get some number, and I see. And what is the estimator of that probability for that coin? Maybe it is not 50%, maybe it's 60%. And this is the formula for the probability given n coin flips, and you get k heads given some probability, or excuse me, given this probability parameter of the coin turning up heads. And it's concentrated at, well, for a fair coin, it's concentrated at 50-50, at half heads and half tails. And so if I have some data, what I'm really going to get is something like 53 heads and 47 tails. It won't be perfectly split, even if it's a fair coin. Once in a blue moon, it will be. But what's the most likely probability, P? And so in maximum likelihood, this is simply defined as the P, which maximizes the probability in the previous formula for you flipped 100 coins and you got 53 heads. It's very simple, and it can be solved with simple first-year calculus. It's usually solved by taking the sum of the logarithm of the probabilities, so-called log likelihood, and that's easier to work with mathematically, as it is here. And it comes out as a very simple thing. You take the number of heads and divide by the number of times you flip the coin. Very simple, very intuitive. And for simple cases like one-dimensional data, things like the binomial data, a lot of times you can't actually come up with a formula based on the data that tells you what the estimator is. You can get, it can work out relatively straightforward. And scientists, people like Fisher, they started with relatively simple distributions, and it got more and more complicated. And today, we use computers, and we have extremely complicated data sets, which I'll talk about in a minute. So it's common sense. The basic concept predated Fisher. So when people were, I'll talk about astronomy, I'll talk about the method of least squares. And people try to justify the method of least squares, which was used for determining the orbits of planets. It was developed mostly by Gauss, and then further advanced by people who were doing more practical work than Gauss. And so the question was, how do you justify the method of least squares? I'll explain what the method of least squares is in a minute. But in the process of just coming up with sort of justifications for why this worked, some of these people like Chauvenet, whose work Fisher read and studied as a student, they came up with an argument which is basically a maximum likelihood type criterion. The method of least squares works because this gives you the most probable position of the planet, or the most probable trajectory of the planet, the one which gives the highest probability of the measurements we actually see. And it turns out that it's equivalent to maximum likelihood if you assume that your errors, your measurement errors, have a Gaussian distribution, the bell curve, a normal distribution. And then it's equivalent to the maximum likelihood method. Now, in the context of astronomy and least squares, this was a special case. This was the only place that people really thought of defining it this way. And it also wasn't fully worked out. There were some problems in the way that Chauvenet and some of the other astronomers argued about this. So it was the beginning of an idea. It hadn't been developed into a theory which would explain statistics and probability in general, a way of applying this to many different situations and to situations where your measurement errors were not a Gaussian. So the method of least squares is equivalent to maximum likelihood if your measurement errors are a Gaussian. But maximum likelihood can be defined where your errors are not a Gaussian. They have quite different shapes, they work differently. But the concept is the same, and you can apply, in some cases you can solve it with calculus by maximizing, finding the maximum of the function. And in some cases, calculus doesn't work. Any of these complex data sets, like in speech recognition, we can't figure it out with calculus. It's too complicated. But we can do it by numerical methods. We can find where the maximum of the likelihood function is, what parameters will maximize the probability that you're going to see the data we actually see. Maximum likelihood is usually right if the frequentist assumptions are correct. But some people spend a lot of time looking for cases where it's actually wrong, where the maximum likelihood estimator actually gives you the wrong answer. And there are actually these really weird cases of sort of combining several probabilities in a really weird way where it doesn't estimate correctly. And I'll get into the story. You don't encounter them very often. I've never encountered them, but they've at least theoretically been shown to give the wrong results.
And this John?
Yes.
Would a bimodal distribution be an example?
It's something like that. There's some weird ones where you like flip a coin and you use this distribution in one case if the coin comes up one, and a different, like weirdly constructed distribution if the coin comes up the other way. So it's like a composite of a couple of distributions, and it doesn't behave the way you would intuitively think it would. That's about as much as I know. I looked through this a little bit, but there was actually a conference to figure out ways to break maximum likelihood back in the 1940s.
And wow.
I'll get to why that happened.
There's a lot of pathology going on.
I'll tell a little bit of the story. So for simple cases, maximum likelihood works pretty well today. I mean, it's really very old. Some of what is maximum likelihood is least squares fitting, which goes back to Gauss and has its roots, as I'll explain, in Kepler and Copernicus, and literally 2,000 years of attempting to model the motions of the planets. So fairly simple cases, it's fairly well understood. There are very good algorithms that do it. They're in CD players. They're in your airplane that you're flying in. Today we have much more complicated data. We have much more challenging problems where the models have many parameters, where the data has many dimensions, many measurements make up the data. It's been increasingly applied to classification, to deciding whether something's a cat or a dog. In speech recognition, you have problems like, did someone say ice cream, like ice cream you eat? Or did they say I scream, like a terror movie, horror movie? They're very similar. And in fact, in normal speech, they're often identical. You can't tell them apart from the acoustics of them. Look at them. If you enunciate very slowly, carefully, you have I scream or ice cream. But in normal speech, everything is flowing together more. And so you use context information. You use statistical models in things like that and naturally speaking. So you look at the neighboring words to ice cream. So probably eat was a neighboring word to ice cream. You probably would interpret it as ice cream that you eat. And I don't know what you do with ice cream, probably like axe. If you had axe with ice cream, you probably would go for ice cream. So when I get to the areas on the modern methods, the computer methods, I'll talk more about this. In fact, here we go. So in maximum likelihood classification, we typically build models for the different classes. So we might have a cat model and a dog model, or eye screen and ice cream, for example. And what we want to say is we have these measurements of this thing we're looking at. Maybe it's a cat, maybe it's a dog. For which model is it more probable that I would see that data? So what are we using for that? That's not always clear. With, for example, household domesticated dogs and cats, probably one of the things we're using is whether they have forward-facing pointy ears. Most domestic dogs don't, but a few do. And typically you're combining a bunch of these different features, and any individual one is not going to necessarily tell you something's a cat versus a dog. You put several of them together, you have some, maybe there's an 80% chance from one of them and 80% from another. When you put them together, you may get a pretty high level of confidence that you're looking at a cat or you're looking at a dog. So I'm just going to power through this. So one of the things you might do is try to figure out whether you're dealing with a rigged coin or a fair coin. And you can actually estimate from the binomial probability, the probability based on, say I flip it 10 times and I get 10 hits. What's the probability it's fake, it's rigged, it's unfair? Well, there's a 1 in 1,000 or 1 in 1028 chance that happened by chance. If it's a fair coin. And on the other hand, if it's a rigged coin, that might be extremely probable. So you can calculate, given certain assumptions, how probable you have a rigged coin. And if you flip it 10 times and it comes up heads 10 times in a row, you're starting to get suspicious that it's a rigged coin. You do 20 or 30, you're really getting suspicious. So that's a simple classification using a probability model. And there are many, as I said, there are many more advanced classification problems where people apply statistical models. The purpose is to say, is it more likely that what you saw came from somebody saying something or from a particular type of animal or a particular type of source? Okay, any questions on that? Anything that needs clarification? Or okay? All right. So I'm going to talk a little bit about mostly astronomy and the background of astronomy. So Fisher studied astronomy at Cambridge. He got a degree in astronomy. And his first papers are on basically the method of least squares. So he was drawing on these ideas from astronomy and applying them to eugenics, for example, which I'll talk about, and agriculture. And they spread throughout the entire scientific world, the engineering world. But they had their start in astronomy. So early astronomy is one of the earliest areas where you have mathematical modeling. And in the ancient world, the wheel was high technology. It was your iPhone. It was the one thing they knew, and they got primitive trigonometry. So they tried to model the motion of planets, like Mars, as uniform circular motion. So you just have this wheel, and it's going around. Probably heard some of this. And there's a big problem with this from the very beginning, which is if you follow Mars, our nearest neighbor, and you watch it going through the zodiac, every couple of years, it'll go up to about here, and then it'll start backing up for a couple of months, and then it keeps going. So there's no way it's going in a uniform circle around the Earth. That was known like 500 BC. So a long time ago, probably in Sumeria, probably in what's now Iraq, people said, well, maybe it's going in a uniform circle around this other thing, which is going in a uniform circle. And in that way, you can explain how Mars is coming around like this, and then it backs up for a little while, and then it keeps going. You can explain it sort of, but you're still off by a few degrees. So they kept adding more and more circles, and these are the infamous epicycles. Now, I learned this with a lot of, in high school physics and astronomy, with a lot of ridicule, but it's also important to understand how people, up until relatively recently, were looking at the planets. They did not think of the planets as big stones flying around in space, driven by gravity. They thought of them as living beings. In the ancient world, they were gods, and in the Renaissance, they were angels. So think of these as people dancing, like a waltz. And if you know the waltz, you go around in a circle, but you also go around in another circle with your partner as you're going forward, and you actually can back up. And if you think of them as dancers following these mathematical rules, then it makes more sense. And that's how they were looking at what they were seeing. So by about 1600, there were several different models of the solar system, none of which worked very well. The best one was this geocentric model of Claudius Ptolemy. They all made this assumption of uniform circular motion. Very simple assumption. Everybody made it. Nobody questioned it. And any model built on uniform circular motion did not work. It would be off by a few degrees, no matter how many epicycles you added. So along came this fellow, Johannes Kepler, and he said, no, it's not uniform circular motion. It's non-uniform elliptical orbits. So when the Earth or Mars is going around the Sun is at one of the focuses of the orbit, and the planet is going here, and it moves slower when it's further away from the Sun and faster when it's closer than the Sun. And in fact, in such a way that it sweeps out the same area in the same time. So when you're far away, it doesn't go very fast because you have this long radius. So A2 and A1, say that's a month, are the same. Now, he did not express it this way. He expressed it in a very hard to understand way. He wrote this 1,000-page book in Latin, which is very hard to read with this discovery. And it took a long time for people to absorb the discovery, but it led to Newton's theory of gravity. It led to a really solid understanding of planetary motion. So before this, your accuracy was maybe 1%. So that means you're off by 3 degrees when you're trying to figure out where Mars is going to be. And now it's like 1 in 100,000. Tiny, it's like an arc second, it's very small. And so in the years following Kepler, Gauss in particular developed the method of least squares, which was a very advanced way of fitting these orbits of objects, the planets, and by the time of Gauss they had asteroids that actually detected Ceres, which was the largest asteroid, like 500 miles across, and they could predict where these guys were going to go. And these methods were also applied to surveying, to navigation by the Navy. And so this fellow, Gauss, wrote in Latin and nobody could understand him. And this is William Chauvenet. He was an astronomer and surveyor for the US Navy. He'll fund the Naval Academy. And he wrote a very widely read book on how to do this. This is the book that Fisher read and where he started from. So there's this huge history of developing these methods. As part of this, they needed to understand some kind of concept of errors and some kind of concept of probability, because your measurements are not perfect. You go with a telescope, and you look in the telescope, and you know, remember, these were human beings doing this. They didn't have modern equipment, and so they'd be writing something down, and they'd have like a little gauge or something, and read the gauge, and they'd get these kind of imperfect measurements. And sometimes people would make mistakes writing things down, so you'd flip two digits, which could give you a value that was way off, basically. So they had to develop some method of dealing with this. And as part of that, Chauvenet and a few other people came up with a concept that's pretty similar to maximum likelihood. Let's say it's the daddy or the granddaddy of maximum likelihood, to justify why this all actually worked.
Excuse me?
Yes.
I know all these guys, but Rudolf II, what was his role?
He paid for it.
For Kepler,
Tycho Brahe. Tycho Brahe. So Rudolf II was the Holy Roman Emperor in about 1600. He was a member of the Habsburg family, and he was kind of nutty. He was fascinated by astrology, alchemy, magic. These things basically are the same as science at this point. This idea that they were separate is really inaccurate. And so he literally funded hundreds of people. He took most of the money of the Holy Roman Empire and funded what was essentially a giant research program. He brought alchemists and astrologers and all sorts of strange people to Prague to do what we would call research. And a lot of it was alchemy and other strange things. And most of this led nowhere, and it was a total failure. But in the case of Tycho Brahe and Johannes Kepler, this is his big, the one thing he invested in that it didn't do much good for the Holy Roman Empire. They got bankrupt. They were invaded by the Turks. Rudolf II was overthrown because he wasted the treasury on this.
Yeah.
But for the human race, it paid off, and we got this major advance in understanding how the planets work. And, I mean, theory of gravity, all of this, well, Newton's work is all based on this. Because once you have this, then you can figure out that the inverse square law will produce this behavior.
So we wouldn't have the iPhone today if it weren't for Rudolf.
It's
entirely possible.
Maybe somebody else would have figured it out, but
I actually read that his Kepler's mother was convicted by him in witchcraft and burned.
She was not burned. She was
something like that.
She was accused of witchcraft. She was convicted of witchcraft, and fortunately, she was not burned. She was they did actually have less severe punishments for witchcraft. So,
Was it Rudolf who actually?
I don't think so. It's complicated because the Holy Roman Empire, as they say, was neither holy nor Roman nor an empire.
Yes.
It was basically a confederation of nearly mostly German-speaking countries. There were a few Slavic countries or areas. It was mostly Catholic, but it had Protestant kingdoms as well. And the kings, the big shots in these different city-states and kingdoms would get together and elect the Holy Roman Emperor to be sort of the boss, but each one was very independent. So he had money, was usually a member of the Habsburg family, and so he was important, but it wasn't like an absolute dictator or like the Roman Emperor. It was, he was kind of like, if they had a dispute or something, they'd come to him and he'd say, well, you know, it was like the Supreme Court or something like that. It was not an absolute monarch.
Chairman of the board.
Yeah, in some companies this would be like chairman of the board. So as I said, all of this work in astronomy led to the method of least squares. And least squares is also a relatively simple idea, which is, so this is a linear least squares fit where we just fit a line, just to make it very simple. And we have a bunch of these measurements and they're scattered around the line. And before the method of least squares, what you do is very simple. You get a ruler, you position it here and say, I think that looks good. And you try to find one that to your eye looked good, but that was so-so. The method of least squares is you want to figure out by a calculation the line which minimizes the sum of the squares of the distance between your line and the measurement. Very simple criterion, and it turns out to work pretty well. And the reason it works pretty well is because it, in fact, is the maximum likelihood estimator if your errors are the normal Gaussian distribution. Now, it took some time for people to realize that and make all those connections. So like a lot of these things, people figure out how to do it, and then they figure out why it works. Which is the opposite of the impression you have from textbooks. They'll show you this beautiful theory, and then they say, because of this beautiful theory, this works. And in history, it's almost always the opposite. Someone figured out how to do it, and then somebody said, we have to understand how this works, why it works. So this is, for probably most of you seen this, but this is the normal distribution. And this is one of the gotchas, because although you're always taught the normal distribution, a lot of real-world distributions aren't really normal distributions. But they often have tails. They often have stuff out here. In astronomy, this was like the flipping the digits and things like that would happen. And so the way they actually kind of got this to work was they would clean the data. They'd say, these are probably lousy measurements. Throw those out. Then do the least squares fit. And then it works right. And so, for example, if you read about Kalman filters, which are basically least squares fitting, the real Kalman filter used, like when we go to the moon or in CD, somewhere buried in them, there's something that's sort of cleaning up the data a little bit before it actually does the fit. This is an example of a distribution that's has a lot of unpleasant properties and has a very long tail. So one of the things about this is if you want to estimate where this peak is, you generally don't want to use the average or the position of the measurements you get from something with this error. It'll often be way off. If you use the median, however, you'll usually be right. And so it's an illustration of this issue that we have a lot of things actually in statistics that are based on the normal distribution. You're taught the central limit theorem and the first year probability in statistics, and they show examples like actually binomial flipping coins where the thing very nicely, as you get the large numbers, looks like a Gaussian. But a lot of real distributions don't do that, and some of them are very much not like that. And so things like the average and things like that aren't actually what you should do. Okay, any questions on that? Anything that needs clarification? Yes?
So a test of normality would be to see if your mean and your median are the same, and if they're not, then you probably haven't got a normal distribution.
Yeah, there's a number of tests like that. One of the things that Fisher and his colleagues and competitors worked on a lot was various kinds of tests like that to determine if your assumptions about your data were reasonable. So you can actually compute, there are actually test statistics to compute, is your assumption about normality correct, and that type of thing. So that's one of the, and in fact, that's one of the things, the maximum likelihood when you start doing it is calculus and you do fancier things with it. One of the purposes was to derive these precise tests and calculations to let you know, or is the assumption of that it's a normal distribution correct? Because that is actually once that's true, it's very powerful, but if you incorrectly assume that something is Gaussian, very bad things can happen. For example, in the financial crisis in 2008, if you look at a lot of these valuation models for derivatives, mortgage-backed securities, they assume a Gaussian distribution. Not the distribution of returns on financial assets. They're nothing like a Gaussian. So this is Ronald Fisher, as I said, in 1913. This is an award from the Eugenics Society, by the way. He was born in 1890, so this was born when Queen Victoria was still alive. And as I said, he drew very heavily on astronomy, because that's where he started to be trained, but there was another major driver of statistics and probability research in the 1800s, and that was eugenics, and I'll talk a little bit about that later. So he also drew on the research and work of Francis Galton and especially Carl Pearson, so I'll talk more about them in a little while. He pulled them together and came up with maximum likelihood. He came up with a lot of other things in the 20s and 30s. I'm focusing on his first big thing, which was maximum likelihood, and then he did a number of other things in the 30s. And his ideas spread through the English-speaking world. They spread far beyond his immediate circle of people that he worked with. into many other fields where they're still alive and kicking today. This is George Snedecor, who wrote a kind of easier to read book about Fisher's ideas in the 30s in the US, and then it was read by all sorts of people in the United States who then proceeded to do what Snedecor said to do, and most of them don't know who Fisher was, but so it spread very far and very wide into many, many fields, far beyond astronomy and far beyond eugenics, which is mostly dyed. So Fisher was very much a product of the English upper crust. This was the heyday of the British Empire. The sun never set, as they said. He attended the elite Harrow School, so that's kind of a prep school for, you know, very rich people. He went to Cambridge. He studied astronomy at Cambridge. He stayed another year at Cambridge studying astronomy before. He had a long series of short jobs as a teacher. He tried to be a farmer for, I think, several months, about a year. He went to a lot of things before he ended up at Rothamsted Research, where he was from 1919 to 1933. And so Rothamsted Research was an agricultural research. They were trying to breed better plants and food, and it overlapped a lot with his interest in eugenics, which was breeding better people. And during this kind of period, when he was kind of bouncing around, he did this foundational work in maximum likelihood between 1912 and 1922.
Well, he peaked early, huh?
Well, he did a lot in the 1930s as well. In his 30s. So, for example, analysis of variance and a number of other things were done after maximum likelihood at Rothamsted Research. It's a complicated story. He eventually ended up working in the same department as Carl Pearson, and there were more problems. I'll tell a little bit more of the story.
This is the Fisher T-test, then, huh?
Yeah. You hear these names like Student and Fisher and Pearson. This is a very small group of people who all knew each other and had kind of complicated interpersonal relations.
And design of experiments?
Design of experiments,
When did he do
that? That was done at Rothamsted Research.
Soil patterns there.
Yeah, a lot of that was done at Rothamsted Research. Right. Yeah, that's done after the work on maximum likelihood, although he's building on this idea of how probability and statistics works. So, to kind of understand part of the reason he had such impact is that when he was at Cambridge, he was involved in the eugenics society there, the eugenics movement there, and he came very close to Major Leonard Darwin. So this is Charles Darwin's son. And the Darwins, the Galtons, and the Twitchwoods, it's kind of an extended family. They're all intermarried. They were the driving forces in the eugenics movement. And they were very wealthy. These are all people who are descended from people who made huge fortunes in the Industrial Revolution, late 1700s, early 1800s. They were very influential. They were very successful. They were successful in politics, in academia, in business. And so Darwin became, according to daughter, Fisher's daughter, his kind of surrogate father. He was his mentor. He provided a lot of advice. He helped support him in these research activities. He provided money. So he played a big role, and so he was like in his 50s, I think. So as I said, Fisher actually starts with the works of Chauvenet and a couple of other people in astronomy and surveying, and they worked out the method of least squares, and Chauvenet has kind of a hand-waving argument that's basically maximum likelihood to justify why you do least squares fitting, why it works. And so Fisher starts here in astronomy, and he calls what he later calls maximum likelihood the absolute criterion. He's trying to generalize least squares fitting. He's trying to generalize what's being done in astronomy into a general theory of probability and statistics, one he can apply to a lot of these problems in eugenics, and in particular to Pearson's correlation coefficient. So one of the issues in eugenics is correlations between different things, correlations between your ancestry and your performance, or correlations between how much money you have and your performance, things like that. And so he starts with astronomy, but he starts moving into applying, how can I use this maximum likelihood principle to correctly estimate the correlation coefficient, to figure out what the distribution of the calculated correlation coefficient is. It turns out it's kind of an oddly behaved function. And all of this brings him into conflict with Carl Pearson and Carl Pearson's followers. And I'll say a little bit about that in a minute. And he finally, so after a decade of this, he produces this paper in 1922 called On the Mathematical Foundations of Theoretical Statistics, very modest title. And this is his, you know, his final sort of synthesis of these ideas. He comes up with and calls it maximum likelihood, absolute criterion goes away. He goes mostly for a frequentist interpretation of probability. He works out these methods that are then will spread throughout the world and form the basis of what's taught in most textbooks today. So this is kind of his sequence. And a little bit about Francis Galton, Carl Pearson. So Francis Galton was Charles Darwin's cousin. He was, Darwin was wealthy because of his maternal grandfather, Josiah Wedgwood. And Darwin money actually mostly came from the Wedgwoods. But Galton's grandfather was a Galton, and they were also wealthy for other reasons. And so Galton, his father died when he was 22, and he became independently wealthy. He was an extremely wealthy guy. He was very intelligent. He went exploring Africa. He invented a bunch of things. He's responsible for the use of fingerprints for identification. He did a lot of things. He's a very smart guy. But he became intrigued, partly by reading The Origin of the Species, being intrigued with the idea that it, what he came to call intelligence, he was first saying immanence, but he came to think, well, there's intelligence, and intelligence is inherited. And the reason his family has so many successful people, so many professors, and so on, isn't because they're rich, it's because they're naturally intelligent. And he wrote a whole series of books promoting this point of view. I mean, he was very serious about this, and he ran into a lot of opposition to this point of view. There were many people that questioned it. So he wanted to put it on a very scientific basis, to use measurements, to use statistical methods, to support what he was saying, not just as it's my opinion or here's some data, to put it on a very solid basis. So he essentially hired and bankrolled Carl Pearson to develop rigorous statistical methods, like the correlation coefficient, to try to prove his theory. And so they developed a lot of very sophisticated stuff, which is in widespread use today. Whenever we use the correlation coefficient, that's Pearson's work. A lot of the early statistics was driven by this, by trying to make eugenics into a, let's say, a scientific, I don't know, engineering, I don't know what to call it, but put it on a very solid basis. And this kept going kind of as a family business. So the chair that Galton took his fortune and endowed a chair, the university that Pearson was a professor at, and Pearson was the professor. And then when Pearson died, his son Egon became the holder of that chair. And so one of his other, not Carl Pearson's son, but one of his main sort of proteges was Jerzy Nyman, who eventually came here to Berkeley. And so there was like this group that sort of orbited around Galton and Pearson. It wasn't very large, but these were sort of the driving forces in English statistics and in many ways in the world. I mean, when you look for statistics and you're talking, seeing a lot of these methods, it's these people. And all did not go smoothly in this world. So Fisher, when he's doing this maximum likelihood work, whether this was, you know, whether his ego was involved or not, he began to question an awful lot of Pearson's work. So he began to throw out what we now call Bayesian probability, which is what Pearson's work was founded on. He began to question things about the correlation coefficient. He began to say in these papers things that were critical of Pearson's work. And Pearson, as you can imagine, was not happy. And he raised questions about Fisher's work. And you know, Fisher claimed that he, like, rejected some of his papers, and they got very, very heated. And it's one of the reasons that I bring this up, in addition to it being kind of an interesting story, is it colors interpreting a lot of this stuff. When you read a lot of this, you'll find these nitpicky, like, frequentist versus Bayesian, they're really weird disputes. And sometimes they're serious, scholarly, you know, there's an objective scientific issue here, and sometimes it's spillover from this feud that developed between these people, and it kept right on going. So Pearson died in 1936, and it just transferred from between Fisher and Carl Pearson to Egon Pearson and Jerzy Nyman. And Jerzy Nyman came here to the U.S. to Berkeley and kept it right on going. So he had, now when I told you about this conference to try to find something wrong with maximum likelihood, this is Jerzy Nyman and his students. And they had a whole conference to find these obscure cases where maximum likelihood is wrong. And to some extent, you'll see, you know, echoes of this in the present day in statistics, because they had students, and Fisher had some students, and Pearson's, you know, group had more, and they kept arguing about some of these things. So the practical concern that you have is some of these disputes are people's personal feelings. They're not scientific.
At the same time, there's a Pearson-Neyman lemma.
Yeah.
Which is, I guess, Egon's Pearson.
Yes, exactly.
Not the
yeah. In fact, that's they're actually putting Fisher, some of Fisher's work on a more rigorous, or so they say, basis. I mean, it's difficult to pull it apart because some of these issues are serious. If there was no personal conflict between these people, these would still be issues, and they were right to argue about them, and some of them we haven't resolved. But some of it was people, you know, they if you read accounts of people who are involved in it, it's like these people hated each other. They really did not get along, and so it colors a lot of this stuff and how you interpret it. You have to be aware that there were these emotions going on behind these arguments. And so maybe my summary on Fisher. So Fisher had a lot of faults. Everybody says he had a bad temper. He would lose his temper pretty easily. He was not the nicest guy. His daughter, there's a different documentary, he says he didn't suffer fools lightly. Yeah. On the other hand, it's pretty clear when you read about it, he was very, very successful. I mean, if you think about it, this guy in his 20s, he comes in, he takes the stuff from astronomy, and he revolutionizes this field. He was very successful, and his success, you know, people were jealous. They resented it. Okay, are there any questions at this point? Anything I need to go over? Okay, so now I'm going to talk about maximum likelihood today in the computer era. So in Fisher's time, we're talking about people whose most powerful computers were adding machines, basically. That's all they had. They might get a room of people with adding machines to do some calculations. So they could analyze very small data sets, very simple models. They were typically working in one or two dimensions at most. They had limited ability to collect data. They had relatively small data sets. I mean, today we can collect huge data sets. But they might have 1,000 data points. That'd be a big data set in their day. Their models were usually pretty simple. But today, with computers, with modern, you know, gizmos and sensors, we can collect large amounts of data. We can do very complex models. The basic method isn't changed. You want to estimate a parameter or make a classification based on finding the parameter that when you put it into the statistical model means that the measurements you see are the most likely. And in one or two dimensions, that's usually pretty simple. That's often the peak of the distribution. And so it works well for simple cases, and the gotchas and issues with it, I think, have been mostly worked out for simple curve fitting, things like that. And it's actually often real time on modern computers if you're just doing any simple cases. But we have much higher dimensional data, much larger data sets, and much more complicated models today. So that's speech, that's somebody talking. An image has at least three dimensions. You have position, and you have at least the intensity of the image. Video, you have at least four dimensions. You have position, you have the intensity, and you have the time component. So a lot is going on in the video. In particle physics, you have hundreds of dimensions. Events are very complicated. So let me talk a little bit about how sort of the big picture of the parameter estimation. That's simpler than a classifier. So we'll start with parameter estimation. So typically you have some data, you have a human being, and you typically will pre-process the data in some way, look at the data, and come up with some model based on the data, based on theories that you have.
Don't you have to have a model to pre-process the data?
Yeah, there's kind of this chicken and the egg question.
Yeah.
Right, so that's where people come in. But, I mean, I've worked with situations where you just have the data. You don't know why it's doing what it's doing. So what the human will typically bring into it is maybe, this looks like this function that I've seen before, so I'll try that function. And that's totally empirical. You don't have any concept of what's happening. But in many cases, we have some idea what's going on. We have theories in physics, we have our own personal experience. If you're watching a video, you probably know there's people in it, and the people are doing certain things. You have information that helps you decide how to look at the data. So you construct a model. Sometimes they're totally empirical. You just pick a function that looks like the model. in more often maximum likelihood, there's a conceptual understanding going on. There's a physics theory, or there's some story that you're telling yourself of what's going on in the video. Something like that is brought to bear. So you build a model, and you fit the model to the data. So the model will typically have a lot of adjustable parameters, and you try to find that set of parameters which best matches the data. And a fair amount of the time, when you try to look at how good the fit is, now it's not really that good. So then you have to go back and try to figure out what's going on. And if you get one that's good, then you have an estimate of parameters. So with a GPS system, people went through some kind of process like this. You know, we didn't model time delays from general relativity, so it's not really working that well. So we go back and we add in, you know, general relativity, you know, the clocks slow down while the satellite is flying around in deep space for low Earth orbit. And so after you go through this, you get parameter estimates. So, but a lot of attempts are to use maximum likelihood for classification problems, where you're assigning something to a class. For example, here, is that a cat, or is that a cat? And when you look at it, I'm sure, how many people think this is a dog? How many people think that's a dog?
Okay.
Most people. Well, I mean, one of the mysteries is people often can make these classifications very well, and yet when you try to turn it into some kind of computer model that makes that classification, it will often not do very well. Supposedly, deep learning is doing better, but why is it that you tell the difference? I mean, if you think about it, you can identify some things, like I said, the pointy ears, forward-facing pointy ears. But there are dogs that have forward-facing pointy pointy ears.
Papillon.
I'm sorry?
The papillon. Right.
I mean, there's several that
German
have.
German Shepherds,
yeah. Yeah, there's several that have the forward-pointing ears. So it's not a perfect separator. Maybe the whiskers. You don't see whiskers too much in dogs, but I'll bet there's some dogs that have whiskers. So classifiers are more complicated to build than estimating a parameter. So again, you start out with data, and here I've kind of broken the data into training data, validation data, and real data. And the training data has got to be a large, usually these are a large data set where you've labeled what the different things are. These are pictures of cats, these are pictures of dogs. This is somebody saying cat, or somebody saying ice cream, this is somebody saying ice cream. And so you fit maximum likelihood models for each class to the training data. So you're trying to build models for these different classes. In a lot of cases, like with speech recognition, you try to construct a generic model, say for a word, a sound that somebody makes. And then it has some tunable parameters in it that allow you to build a model of a particular sound or a particular word that the person would say. And so you do a fitting process to build these very often in these fitting process to build these class models. And in the case of something like speech recognition, there are literally hundreds of thousands of words. So you actually, in a way, have hundreds of thousands of these models that have to be generated in current speech recognition algorithms. So things like Dragon Natural Speaking are very complicated under the hood. The database that's inside them is something like a gigabyte in size. But, so once you build those models and you think you've got the right ones, then you want to make sure you haven't sort of memorized what's in the training data, that you're able to recognize these classes in data that wasn't used for the training process. Make sure that the model is really valid. So you have to go through a process of checking. Once I think I know what a dog is, if I get some new pictures of dogs I've never looked at before, can I still tell that this is a dog? Occasionally, just like neural networks or other types of classifiers, you go through this wonderful training process and it says, we've all figured it out, and you show it something new, and it doesn't work right. There's this famous story about tanks. How many people have heard the tank story? This is a story, I think, about neural networks. And the story is that the Army has somebody, we want to identify tanks in pictures, so they have this big database of pictures of tanks and not tanks, you know, open fields. And the neural network gets trained, and it does it perfectly. And every picture they show of the tank, it goes tank. And every picture that isn't a tank, not a tank. So then they take it out of the field, it fails totally. And you're like, why doesn't it recognize tanks? So they went back through and examined why it was working. It turned out all the pictures that were used for the tanks were like in, it was something like they were in daylight, and the ones that weren't tanks were taken like at night or something like that. So it lied and correctly identified something that in the training state was perfectly correlated with being a tank. It had nothing to do with being a tank. So now that tends, that is particularly prone to happen in things like neural nets where you really don't know what's going on. But a human being can do the same thing. They can construct a model that's going for something that's correlated in the training set and isn't actually how you recognize something. So you have to go through this kind of validation process to check that it really is, you have really captured what determines whether something's a cat or a dog or a tank or whatever. So if all of that works and it's classifying okay, then you can feed real data through it. And what it will do usually in a lot of these is it will then fit these models. And so some of the parameters have been fixed to make them models of dogs and cats, but they have other parameters that are still free, and you need to figure out, you know, is this a small dog or a big dog? So you figure out like the size of your dog model, and you want to pick the size that most closely matches the animal that you've seen. There's small dogs, there's big dogs. And then you compare that to the model for the cat. And again, your model for the cat will have different sizes possible. Same, so both models should decide that the animal, whatever it is say 2 feet long or something like that. And once it's done that, you say, which of these is the most probable? You know, does it have the pointy ears or not? And whatever other criterion it's using to say it's probably a cat or probably a dog. So if all that works, we get the right answer. So just to repeat, there's usually actually fitting going on both in the training process and in the actual recognition process. And when we're training, we fix certain parameters that are typically associated with membership in the class. So we might know that cats tend to have these pointy ears, and so that's what we fix on. When we're doing the recognition, when we're dealing with real data, we fix those parameters, but we have other things that are properties of the things we're looking at that can vary for different members of that same class. So, as I said, cats can be small, they can be larger, dogs can be small, they can be larger. And so we have to do a fitting process during the recognition. So when we're out there in the real world looking at some video camera surveillance and we want to decide, is that a cat or a dog, or is it a tank? We have to do some additional fitting to be sure that we identify correctly. I wanted to say, are there any questions at this point? Okay. All right. Oh, yes.
Well, just a quick question. Like on the cat-dog model, those probabilities aren't necessarily mutually exclusive, are they? Like it's not 70% dog, 30% cat, but it could be both like 70% dog.
Yeah, what's usually done in maximum likelihood is just we pick the most probable.
Yeah.
So you can get out of one of these things an ambiguous situation. I mean, you could look at the cat and dog and say, well, the probability that this data came from a cat is 80%. The probability it came from a dog is 60%.
Okay.
Well, that's not a very high, there's a chance they really have a dog there and not the cat. But the maximum likelihood criterion says pick the most probable, and that'll be your classification. In some systems, in order to take that into account, you'll give an ordered list. You'll have, this is the most likely, this is the second most likely, and so on. And that allows you to later process do other things, like the human selection of options, choices in speech recognition. You might say, I think you said this, but maybe you meant this, click on this, those kind of things. So it can give you more information. But okay. Any more questions? Okay, did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. So I just wanted to make a little bit of a comparison to deep learning. So deep learning is in the news a lot. It's getting lots of good press right now. So how does maximum likelihood estimation relate, or classification, because that's usually what we're talking about. But deep learning can also be used for parameter estimation. How does it relate to deep learning? I think they are, in practice, fairly different. Deep learning is what used to be known as artificial neural networks. And so neural networks go way back. They were in vogue in the 50s and 60s, then they went out of vogue, and then they were in vogue in the 80s, kind of early 90s.
When did they become deep learning? Because I learned that it's artificial neural.
Yeah, yeah, that seems to be a marketing term. I mean, they had a lot of trouble getting, like, really good examples of successes back in the 80s and 90s. There was a lot of hype about them. My understanding is they're used in some, like, fraud detection and credit cards. I once interviewed with a company at HNC that was doing so. There were some successes, but a lot of times people just couldn't get them to work very well. So they kind of went out of vogue. And then the new ones are bigger. More neurons are being simulated, more layers of neurons. So that's why they're calling them deep learning instead of having maybe a couple of hidden layers. They have many. They have more powerful computers. If I understand correctly, they have a faster learning algorithms and things like that have been improved over the 80s and 90s era neural networks. So they're based on a very simplified model of neurons in the human brain. If you've ever read a neurology book or a neuroscience book about what a neuron is, they're incredibly complicated. This is a lot, heavily simplified over a real neuron. But the idea is that the neuron has a bunch of things coming into it, and it implements kind of a thresholding function, a sigmoidal response function, and then it sends these things out. And so many neurons will have thousands of connections to other neurons. And so the theory is that in a sort of, when you put a lot of these together in a lot of layers, what this is supposed to show, that this somehow produces human intelligence. And it's kind of the theory is it's kind of like epicycles. It's a model with a huge number of functions, with a huge number of tunable parameters, and it just, through feedback, I mean, I don't know, burning your hand or something, you get feedback, right? It learns some function, some model that actually works. And that's the idea. I think that's probably, I'll explain this, I think it's probably not an adequate explanation of what people do, but that's kind of the idea. So to be fair, there have been a lot of great successes with deep learning reported in the last couple of years. So how many people have heard of the AlphaGo? Couple people. So Go is a board game from Japan. It's extremely complex to play. So it has many more permutations, much more complicated things going on than in chess. And so unlike chess, which eventually fell to just a brute force search where the computer just computes every possible move and picks the winner, you can't do that with Go to this day. It's way too complicated. It's a difficult game to learn, and it's at least difficult for the people who play it to explain why they do what they do. So they may be operating on some sort of feeling they have, which somehow is very accurate. And until quite recently, no one's ever been able to make a computer program that can beat a good Go player. And so AlphaGo is supposedly a deep learning program that beat a leading Go player. I don't know if he's the best in the world, but he's considered very good. And so Go has been held out since... people remember Garry Kasparov in Deep Blue, where the computers actually started being able to beat grandmasters in chess. Well, for a long time, Go has been held out as we can't do that with AI. We can't use a brute force search, so we have to somehow duplicate these intuitive feelings or whatever people are doing that sometimes is so remarkable. And so AlphaGo is said to be a really good example of this, that we've made some real progress, and the deep learning is starting to produce perhaps more like human behavior. So to play Go, to get a computer program to play Go at the champion level or whatever, is really an accomplishment. It's technically difficult. So what are the differences between maximum likelihood? And I think the main difference is that maximum likelihood is based on a conceptual model. You usually have a probability model. You actually are asking yourself the question, what is a cat and what is a dog? Why do we think of them in these two classes? And you need to actually understand that in order for maximum likelihood estimation or classifier to work. It has to really know what's going on or figure out somehow. And in deep learning, we're close to kind of the meaning, what people think about, the concepts. In deep learning, you have a model of the neurons. You have a model of how they're wired together at a very low level that somehow is learning to correctly classify things. So there's no obvious connection between the connection weights and the transfer functions, which are what are learned, and why something is a cat or a dog. And so it also means that if you want to get deep learning to work, you actually do have human experts involved, but they need to be tweaking things at a low level, like how are these neurons wired together, how are these layers put together, what transfer function do we use? How in the world is that connected to membership in the class of cats and dogs, or what someone is saying? And so that presents some significant differences in the two approaches. And in maximum likelihood, we can express our answers as probabilities. Like I was saying, there's a 60% chance this is a cat, and an 80% chance that it's a dog. And as far as I know, we can't really do that with deep learning. It'll just kind of come out and say, hey, I think this is a cat. They may be right, but you don't know why, and you don't even know necessarily how certain the neural net is, this decision, that something is a cat. So there are differences between the two. It's possible that there's some fusion of the two approaches that'll sort of overcome these differences and explain them. There's a lot of things with artificial intelligence we just still don't have very good answers for. We don't know what consciousness is and why we have it. When you think about mathematical modeling and this iterative process by which we come up with a model that works, in a sense, the program, to duplicate what a human does, it has to have a concept of itself. I tried this idea. It didn't work. Here's the history of what I tried. Let me try something new. We do that all the time. But at present, no computer, as far as I know, is actually doing anything like that. Even when people try to automate model fitting, they can't get that. The human is actually aware of its own thought processes and able to adapt and say, this way of thinking isn't working, I'll try a different way. It's hard to do, but we do it. It's hard to do. The more foundational your belief that you have to question to make progress is, the harder it is to do.
I'm just thinking of politics.
So we have flashes of insight. Like Kepler's, this thing that the planetary motions are an ellipse, he worked on this problem for 5 years and made no progress, at least consciously. He was just like, this is complete. He was thinking of giving up. He was like, I can't figure this out. And I don't know why the planets are doing what they're doing. And it was Easter weekend in 1605. He was, I guess, relaxing. This is a very common story with inventions and discoveries. And it hit him. Oh, it's an ellipse. He goes back, and in a couple months, he's got it mostly worked out. It's an ellipse. End of problem.
And I look at a lemon and say, oh.
But there are, I'd say, about a third of major inventions and discoveries that I've read about, there's an experience like this, where the inventor or the discoverer, they usually have been working on something for several years, they don't make any seeming progress, I mean, they've tried a lot of things and failed, and they take a break, they go take a walk, they go on vacation, they're rarely actually consciously thinking about the problem, and then it hits them, oh, wait a minute, if I do this, this is the answer, and then that turns out to be right. And people have tried to say, well, maybe some of the phase transitions in neural networks are like flashes of insight. Well, maybe, but I don't think we understand what people are doing here. One thing that I thought about is, it is true that we have these intuitive feelings. And often when people have these flashes of insight, they can't verbalize at first what the insight is. They may, like Kepler had to read up on ellipses because he didn't know anything about them. But in fact, in many cases, when you start thinking about it, talking with someone, the reasoning process will manifest. You start to figure out what it is that you figured out. You can do what we don't seem to be able to do with neural networks, and we often can figure out. Now, that can take time. It can take years sometimes, but we can translate this feeling into a very specific concept of what's going on. So that differs from what deep learning does right now. And maybe there's some fusion or something we haven't thought of. So the question I would leave you is, does the human brain and neurons work the way mainstream science thinks? And how many people think it works the way mainstream science thinks? Either people are afraid to comment or they don't have an opinion.
Well, mainstream science, there's a couple of different ways it thinks about the brain. So.
Yeah, that's also true, you have to say. That's true. You have to be fair and say there are different theories, particularly about human intelligence.
And mainstream science is also going to try to fit it into the current big model, which is going to change 20 years from now.
So leaving aside deep learning, so these modern things like speech recognition and so on, they usually involve very complex multi-parameter models. So we're no longer talking about fitting a peak with maybe a position and a width of the peak or something like that. We're talking about very complicated models. We're also talking about, very often, at least the training data, if not the real data it's run on in the field, once you get it working, the training data is often very large. So you even hear of people doing things with petabytes, with 1 million gigabytes, which would be the amount of data at, say, 250,000 movies. So it can be quite a lot. So when you get to these problems, it's very hard to come up with a closed form, and maybe impossible in many cases, to come up with a closed form mathematical formula. You just, you know, sum the data or do some vector manipulation or something like you can do in these squares fitting to get your parameter class assignment correctly. So what you need to use are nonlinear optimization methods to search in this parameter of space. You can't exhaustively search it, but you start from what's kind of a good guess usually, and then you kind of look around and see, can I find where the likelihood is its maximum? Which set of parameters gives you the maximum? And there are a lot of methods for doing this. These are two of the most commonly used. So Meldrum-Mead is a kind of geometric approach, and Levenberg-Marquardt is a kind of complicated matrix inversion method that has, it has issues, so sometimes the matrix won't invert, in which case it just crashes or hangs and you can't get anywhere. Meldrum-Mead is very popular because it's very simple, it's relatively easy to explain and implement, and it's relatively robust if your function is kind of badly behaved, and maybe the matrices don't invert, they're singular or something like that. Meldrum-Mead can often work its way through that. And so it's pretty simple. It works based on what is called a polytope or a simplex. And that's basically a geometrical structure. In two dimensions, it's a triangle. It's really simple. And in three dimensions, it's a pyramid, a tetrahedron. And in higher dimensions, you can kind of generalize. So it has enough points so that it sort of fills the space. What you do is you simply, for example, in a two-dimensional case, so I have a model that has two parameters. It could be something like position and width of your peak. And I start my search at sort of a good guess, and I start with this triangle, and I compute the likelihood at each corner of the triangle. And depending on what those values are, I make a decision about how to change the shape of that triangle, change the position of the vertices of the triangle. So for example, let's see, the lowest likelihood was here, and you have two about the same here. And it's pretty likely that the maximum likelihood is in this direction. So I flip this over here, go here, and repeat the process. And there's actually a series of tests that it does, so it actually will shrink it by half, and has this sort of if this, do this, otherwise do that set of criteria to kind of search around in its neighborhood to find the best likelihood. So it's not exhaustively searching the space, but because it has a point in every direction in the space, in the two dimensions or three dimensions, it's a pyramid, it can kind of search around. And if a function isn't too pathological, as long as you start it near the... Can anyone see these?
Yeah.
You can read it? Okay, so this is an example. We start with a triangle here, and mutates a little bit, and it's starting to move in this direction, because it turns out that's the maximum likelihood. So it stretches here. It says this is higher than these two, so I'll stretch here. Tries another possibility. It stretches itself around. It's kind of like jello or something. Eventually, it finds itself at the maximum, and it'll start shrinking. And at some point, it says, I keep looking, and it isn't changing. I seem to have found the maximum. Declares victory, and it tells you that's the maximum likelihood.
A little difficult to see over here, but looking at contour maps?
You're looking at contour maps. They're a horrible shade of blue that is hard to read, and if I had more time, somebody pointed this out to me yesterday, I didn't have enough time to make them a better color, so next version, they won't be a horrible shade of blue.
I know, it's not my eyes, okay.
Yeah, no. This is a very simple algorithm. You can implement it pretty easily, and you can actually understand what it's doing pretty easily, so it's very popular. It's often used in this kind of modeling. It is kind of slow, though, and that's one of the issues. I mean, not slow compared to some things, but it's slow. So in these complicated situations, you're usually using these kind of iterative approaches, these approximate numerical approaches to try to find the maximum likelihood, to find the parameters or the classification that gives you the highest likelihood, the most probable data. And
But in that model there, I only found the local. I didn't find the global.
Yeah, that's why I said you have to start from a good guess. Part of the black art of these things is, and I fudged with like pre-processing, part of the black art of these things is to do something to get a good starting guess, which may be some simplistic criterion to try to figure out where the maximum probably is and then start there. A lot of textbooks and a lot of descriptions of these, they gloss over these kind of gotchas like that, and they don't really give you good pointers on how to do that, and then that's something you learn in practice, or somebody tells you, you know, try this, and that usually works, and it, you know. One of the problems of the maximum likelihood estimator, although you can work around it, is that it's not robust. What does that mean? It means if you have data where the model says nothing's ever going to happen, or it's extremely unlikely that something's going to happen, then the maximum likelihood estimator can get pulled to a quite incorrect value. So what's causing this is that the data isn't really your model. It might be very close to your model, but it's got outliers. It's got stuff in it that's where the model says you either won't see anything or it's extremely unlikely you'll see anything. Least squares fitting, which is an example of maximum likelihood, has that problem.
It's imposed in general.
I'm sorry?
It's imposed.
I think that may be a correct statement. I mean, there's a field that tries to make statistics robust so that given the real world reality that our models are never actually right, or approximately right, we would still like to be able to estimate parameters or estimate what's going on correctly so that the outliers don't cause too many problems.
That's why Levenberg-Marquardt is so good. It has a regularization inside. I use it.
And so one obvious thing you can do is just clean up the data like the astronomers did. I mean, you can automate that in some cases. If the outliers are, you know, you can tell, you know, there's this big blob of data here and there's these three over here, a pretty good chance those are outliers, let's throw them out. That's a kind of ad hoc procedure. And there are robust theories of statistics that try to put that on a more firm basis and kind of weight the way these things work to basically downplay the outliers so they don't pull the estimate way away from what the bulk of the data is telling you. So the simple example of a robust statistic is the median. So if you consider the average and the average is susceptible to outliers. So, you know, you have 100 people and they make $10,000 a year, then you add one person who makes $1 billion a year, your average income will be not representative of, you know, everybody, basically. If you have a median, then very often, unless your data is very noisy, you get a reasonable number. So in that case, median would still be $10,000 a year. It wouldn't be affected by that one abnormal person. And so there are more general ways of doing that for statistics. But they're kind of complicated.
You should tell Trump about that for his it's the economy.
I'm going there.
So in practice, these more complicated methods are often computationally intensive. They often use a lot of memory and CPU cycles. So if you really want to make them work in, for example, real time, like speech recognition, you have to optimize them for speed and memory. So like speech recognition, there's this method of fitting that's specifically optimized for the Hidden Markov models called Baum-Welch, which is faster, and that's part of the reason it can operate in real time today, not years ago. So this adds to the practical issues of implementing these things in the real world. Because often, if you just use these methods, in some cases you can't even analyze the data, but even if you understand what's going on, then to actually use it for real purposes, you need to make it faster. So we're actually going back to problems that Fisher and Galton and Pearson were trying to deal with, which is despite all these sophisticated mathematical methods, it's still hard to distinguish between models that have very similar data distributions. And if they have about the same shape and about the same thing, then the fitting method is not necessarily going to be able to pull them apart. And so you're trying to achieve that and find something that will separate them. But these fancy methods don't necessarily solve that problem. So this is the nature versus nurture problem that Galton was concerned about. Because if you think about it, if you have exceptional intelligence, it's hereditary, okay, maybe it is, and intelligence leads to wealth, power, success, then you expect, you know, certain families, wealthy families, to have high intelligence, right? It's a natural consequence. It goes together. However, if exceptional intelligence is a consequence of expensive education and training, you're taught this stuff. You go to Harrow's, you go to Cambridge, you go to these special schools, and you have tutors and things. Well, you know, wealthy families are going to be intelligent. There's a lot of smart people in them.
So obviously we have a very clear distinction between the two theories.
That's right. They're really easy to tell apart. And, you know, so all these fancy methods still have trouble with this. So let me conclude. And so I want to leave you with both of these methods are for the complicated problems, for not for one-dimensional data and not for fitting a polynomial to a graph with one dimension. That's really, we can do that pretty easily today. And these more complex cases, which often occur in like pattern recognition, classification, the GPS system is still pretty complicated. These things take a lot of work. There's a lot of sort of painstaking, nitpicky work involved to get them to work. There's issues like where you start your iterative search to get to the right thing. So these things remain something of a black art. You can't just take something and drop your data in and it will happily spit out the answer. However, people have been able to get it to work with many systems. GPS is probably the most widely used. But as I said, software keyboards for smartphones, speech recognition are examples. The Higgs boson, there's a lot of scientific work that uses it. So it does work. Mm-hmm. And I think the one other thing I would say is if you're dealing with situations where the frequentist assumptions are really solid, you have lots of repeatable data, you know, you're flipping coins millions of times, you're collecting petabytes of, you know, radiation counts or data like that, you're probably on a pretty firm foundation. And that's not an issue. But when you're talking about some other things, and where maybe that frequentist definition doesn't really work that well, then you have these foundational issues in probability floating around in the background. What are we talking about? When you're talking about sort of softer fields, maybe marketing or finance or things like that, those issues probably do arise because you're often trying to figure out something about a customer, say. Your customers keep changing and the world is complicated. It's not really like flipping a coin. So these issues can feed in. And I don't think we fully resolved these issues. We never resolved this, you know, paradox that the frequentist description describes a lot of things we think of as probability. Like when you're flipping a coin, you say it's 50% chance you get hits, right? Completely logical. We also say 50% in these state of knowledge situations, right? We say there's a 50% chance that Bob likes me, or there's a 90% chance that Bob likes me. And we did, this makes sense, right? It's totally reasonable. It's the way we talk about uncertain knowledge. And it does apply to a lot of places where probability is used. But we haven't fully reconciled those different interpretations. And so those issues do come up in more difficult cases where maybe the data isn't as like flipping a coin. And questions? Yes.
Well, an assumption in a lot of probability is that each data point is independent of the others. Is that assumption, does that have to be included in MLE?
It doesn't have to be. You can have a joint distribution where, you know, past history, for example, is involved. Mm-hmm. In practice, a lot of models do make that assumption without always being explicit that that assumption is being made. But you don't have to make that assumption. The probabilities and the concept of maximum likelihood are defined where there's like historical dependence. Mm-hmm. On what happened before.
So it can deal with like time series data.
Exactly, yeah, very much so. Definitely can be applied to time series. Yes?
I just want to recognize, you know, I'm so grateful for this speech. It's really
fantastic.
Great. You know, I've learned a lot. I'm still puzzled about the deep learning a little bit. Like, actually a lot, you know, so you mentioned the black box. It's, you know, still, and then you use a lot of good examples, like, you know, so very, very genius. They went on vacation, they could relax, and they take years to figure out it works, deep learning works, but how it works. So just, you know, maybe elaborate a little bit more about deep learning in, you know, the future, like what your vision so.
I'm not sure where deep learning is going, so we'll find you know, when you work, you know, professionally with these things, it can become an issue with the deep learning type approaches that you don't know why it's doing what it's doing. If something changes and it stops working, there's no obvious, like, dial you turn. You have to retrain it from scratch because you can't figure out why it stopped working. For example, you have a new sensor. You bring in a new sensor. Maybe it's noisier, for example. You didn't realize that. Or it has some slightly different response to what it's measuring. And you plug that into your neural network, and it stops classifying correctly. And you have no idea why that happened. Right? It doesn't say, wait, it's noisy. It doesn't do any of that. With more conceptual models where you have a physical model of that noise that's in the sensor, you can actually, in some cases, just adjust the model, you know, okay, this is a noisier sensor, and you can tell from the model why something is failing. Whereas in the neural networks today, the current neural networks, as far as I understand, you can't. It's very hard to tell why they stop working or why they do the things that they do. You can envision that maybe a future generation of the neural networks will merge the two of these and will have a more conceptual way of doing things, some of this higher level stuff that human beings are doing, so that it can actually tell you what's happening and respond the way people do, or more like people do, to, you know, the data looks different, there's something has changed. Yes?
Well, I want to first of all echo what Lily said. This is fabulous, thank you. And I've been struggling to ask a question, to think of the question I want to ask, but I've only made it as far as an anecdote and a comment, so
okay.
I can do.
Okay.
I actually was, I'm a physician, and I was involved in neural network work in brain imaging back in the 80s and 90s, and I hasten to say I'm not a statistician. In fact, I'm still trying to learn basic statistics at this advanced age of decay. But we were, what was amusing about it is that we were trying to understand, we were using the then new technique of what's called positron tomography to look at brain function, and we were using the neural network approach to actually try to interpret the images of the brain doing something. So we thought that was quite clever, but the tools were primitive, as you say. They've come a ways, and they're being used still in classification of structures in brain images. So that takes me to the comment, which is that one of the differences between these two approaches, as I think I understand it, I don't know if it's right, is that the MLE methods are maybe more useful in medicine anyway to explain phenomena, whereas the ANN or deep learning is perhaps more attuned to trying to generate hypotheses and help guide a field that knows it doesn't know much. Maybe that's not correct, but let me give you an example of where I'm intrigued to try to take this a little further and learn some more. One of the most important fields is everybody in medicine, everybody knows, is genomics, and trying to understand our the connections of genes and their products and all of that. So and I may be mixing up frequentist and Bayesian here, but basic statistical approaches are applied as a filter to the understanding of whether some gene is related to some other gene, because there's thousands and thousands of connections, and if you look at it in one cell, you might find one relationship, and you look at it in another cell type, a completely different relationship. You don't really know what's... We don't know enough. We don't have a clue, basically, what's going on yet. But so there's filters of probability that are applied. But the deep learning methods are, I think, being used, and I'll do some reading, to help us understand kind of what pathways are and what to kind of guide where research should go. That's as close, it's not a question, but I mean it's an observation, and I'll get back to you in 50 years after I do some reading based done. This is really marvelous. Thank you.
Let's thank Dr. McGowan for
coming.